So I have been in the game industry since 1996. That is when I had just passed out of school, and in my third semester in college, the guy who had been my computer teacher at that time had got an investor, founded a computer game company, and he was trying to make a game, and he had another programmer, and he also wanted me to be a programmer. So in 96 to around 99, I worked part-time in college writing a game engine for him. And after that, I took a job in another software company in Bangalore. I'm from Delhi. I moved from Delhi to Bangalore. And during the year that I was away from this company for which I had made a game engine, that company, on the basis of the technology I had made when I was in college, got acquired for crores of rupees. And they started chasing me that, okay, come and join us, become our senior engineer, become our technology lead, become this and that. And this is, I'm talking about 99, 2000, 2001. So in 2001, I joined that company, and over time, I became the head of the technology team, say 2.5 years after I have come out of college. And we tried to ship this game. We tried to get a publisher. When the game company is not getting a publisher, there's always that sense among the senior management that they say, what else can you do? Can you make e-learning course material? Can we take services work? Do we still have to make this game? And amongst us as programmers and artists and designers, there is the fear that what if the company tomorrow just says, stop, we are all out of job, we can't do it. And just 2.5 years out of college, if I'm heading a technology team, then my greatest fear is not that I will lose my job, but the fear is that I will become a joke among my college mates, that this guy used to think he's a very great programmer and he was good in school and college. And then another guy hired him made him the head of the team in 2 years of experience. And now see how badly the team has done. So at that time, I was like desperate. I said that even if I have to give my life away, I will still somehow fight and pull victory out of the jaws of defeat. And so that went on till 2002, when we brought it to a good level and I left that company. And from 2002 to today, it's 2018. I've just been trying to scratch around in the market, earn money by running my own game company after I left that last company. So in this talk, I'll try to share some of the lessons. I'll try to clarify some of the doubts, because, you know, sometimes I have some relative, some sister of my mother or some relative of my father. They say that, please guide our son, that he is your younger brother. Tell him whether there is scope for it. Tell him what he should do. And if it is not worthwhile, then explain to him whether it is worthwhile or not. There are people who do an internship with us, or people who just come for guidance, and they say that, tell us, what should we do? We see this, and we see this, and we don't know what to do. And obviously, I can't tell anybody what to do, but what I do try to always share is the cycles, the ups and downs, and the waves of the industry that we have lived through, and we were shocked to live through, that the whole house is burning, and should you recover the things you have, or should you save your life? So, coming from that experience and that background, I'll try to share some of my experiences with all of you people. So I'll try to keep this talk interactive so that, I mean, at times I'll ask that, okay, guys, what do you think? So you can share your thoughts. Even in the end, when I ask questions, I'll try to collect all the questions people have, and then I'll try to put together an answer which answers all the things people have, rather than do this that I ask one guy a question and then spend 10 minutes just answering one question and end it. So here we go. I've told you who I am and why I'm talking about this, and obviously you're students and you are in this industry, so you care. So I let me share one story with you people. In around 2012, I had spent 2.5 years making a game. I was trying to make a clone of Battle City, that game we play on Nintendo, the tank shooting game, for Nokia phones, Nokia Symbian phones. So Nokia Symbian phones, for those of you who remember, they were very beautiful phones, the first smartphones. And there were also very limited number of games which actually did justice to that device. And so I was also excited since the time I saw the Nokia 6630 in 2007. And I said that, okay, we will make a tank shooting game and this is the best device to play it on. And we'll make it Bluetooth multiplayer and we'll do lots of great things. And it will be a super, super, super hit. So I spent 1 year, I spent 1.5 years. So it took 2 years, 2.5 years to make that game. And after I released the game, I realized that the people in Nokia who were responsible for promoting games, unlike the guys in Apple who will find the best game and promote it, they were not interested only because their company was sinking. And why will anybody talk to one guy when they can find people who can supply them 100 games? But we tried and tried. And 6-7 months later, we produced a few more apps relating to diseases and health and other things that Nokia wanted to do. We got millions of downloads. And then Nokia was willing to listen to us. And then we worked a little more on our game also. And we realized that one particular day, we got $100 of revenue from the game, which means that 200 copies had been sold at $1 a copy. Another day, we saw that 18,000 ad impressions, or rather 18,000 ad clicks had happened on ads shown in our game, which means more than 100,000 or 200,000 impressions had happened. Another time, we saw that, okay, the ad network is writing to us that you have been collecting your funds for 3 or 4 or 5 months, you can take a payout. So please attach a bank account to your ad network account. And then after attaching a bank account, 1.5 months later, my father said that, son, now your life insurance policy is due. So just cut a check for that, since you are earning your own money. And in between for some time when you were in a bad situation, we were paying the checks for that life insurance. So I went and I cut a check for around 10,000 rupees, cashed it in the bank. And even after the check was cashed, I thought that I had 10,000 rupees. And even then I see a number very similar to the 10,000 rupees I thought I have in the bank. So I went to the bank and I cut a check for cash and I asked them to give me 9,000 rupees. And after I withdrew 9,000 rupees, still the number was 10 and then something zeros and other numbers. And I said that, why is it still 10,000 rupees? So then I looked more closely at the number and I realized that I had around 10 lakh something rupees in the bank. And they had come because of the ad impressions and the app store sales and different things. And being sort of miserly and living on the edge for so long, I could not even imagine that one day I will see that suddenly there are 10 lakh rupees in my account. So I said that, please, do I have to wait with a token to in the line to cash the check? They said, no, sir, we can cash it right away. So they cashed it and give me the money. So after I got the money and I counted the money, I said that, why have you given me the money instantly? The others, you are giving them a token. They said, sir, you are a gold customer. I said, I'm a gold customer. They said, yeah. So if you have more than 5 lakhs of average balance in your account for more than a certain number of months, we make you a gold customer. So you don't have to come in line and we put you in front of the line. As soon as you come, you can do whatever you want. I said, wow, this is great. I said, so now I know that this is the right choice for me. And all the doubts I had are dispelled, that this is why I should have a game industry career, because I worked hard and suddenly all the results, fruits are falling from the sky. So, and looking back, I mean, there are times when people say that, no, there is no scope. So even though one goes through crazy kind of pain, I want to share the scope. I'll also try to share the pain, because sometimes when somebody has family responsibilities and maybe other commitments, then it's important to be realistic. So I'm just going to start sharing this. So, I mean, what do you people think? Like, why should somebody take a career in the game industry? I mean, you all want to go into the game industry. So why do you want to go into the game industry? Okay, passion. What else? Okay, interest. What else? Any other reasons? Okay, a unique form of art. I would say a unique form of art means that your art becomes timeless, like the paintings of Ajanta Ellora or Khajuraho, that even 20 years after you have made it or 100 years later, you think people will come and see it. And okay, anything else? Yeah.
I think it's the biggest entertainment industry and there is a real requirement of talent and competencies which is required to get that entertainment, to get it in your work.
Okay, so what you are, I'll try to reword your thing and you can tell me whether I'm getting it right. So you're saying there's huge opportunity and there's huge demand, which implicitly means there's a lot of money and a chance for people to build a rewarding and financially good professional career in that, right? Okay, so these are some of the things. So yeah, these are some of the reasons people take a game industry career, because you want to do it I mean, and I've tried to list out my thoughts, because you are passionate about games, because you want to make products you can touch and play and which the world will remember and love. That, you know, before Angry Birds came, nobody had thought there will be a game where you slide things across the screen. Nobody had thought that our grandparents or our parents will be playing the game, or they will be lost in their devices. Because you have a skill set for which there's an opportunity in the gaming industry. The gentleman who talked of his training institute, that is what he was saying, that look, if you know programming or you know art, then the game industry is the best and the biggest place for you to be. You know, I mean, obviously that might be true as a fact, even in terms of the financial numbers, but that doesn't change the fact from the risks and the dangers and all the other things. And because you think there is money, or because you are on some company's radar, that they say, okay, you are a BTech, come for our interview. And, or you say that, okay, Electronic Arts is on my radar, or XYZ ABC company is on my radar, and my friend is getting this salary, I will also make a career in that company. So some of the thoughts. So why should you not take a career in the game industry? I mean, if somebody is advising you, or you are telling somebody, that, some close friend, don't go into that. Why should somebody not take it, in your opinion? Okay, risky is one thing. What else? Okay, uncertainty. Okay, anything else? Okay, so yeah, that's one more. That people, there's a fear of the new, because it's not an established path. Okay, anything else? Okay. So let me share what I think is one of the reasons what makes the game industry dangerous. You know, when somebody wants to become a cricketer, at one level it looks beautiful, but in childhood the parents tell us that, son, along with playing cricket or sport or wanting to be a musician or rock star, please, please also study, because that is a proven path where 95% of the people will get the desired results. While if you are trying to become a rock star or you're trying to become a musician or artist, maybe 5% of the people get results, and sometimes even 90% of the people fall down. And you know, as we people, as energetic, brave, passionate people, we try to focus on what we want, you know, the target, the goal. But it's a fact that there's something called the software poverty line. So this is a photo of a slide that was shown yesterday in the Google Developer Day, in a presentation. So, and by one of the presenters. So this slide says that according to a company called Vision Mobile, 60% of the developers now fall under the app poverty line. They make less than $500 per month, and 15% are making no revenue at all. Only 1 in 9 developers that rely on app store revenues are in the safe zone of making $10,000 per month. 8 lakh or 800,000 new mobile app developers enter the market each year. So developer doesn't just mean that there is a boy who's sitting in his parents' house and he's writing software or he's writing an app. Developer also means app development company. You know, that you get a job with a company, you are very happy. They say you will be an intern for a certain amount of time, or you will start on this salary. And they are not making money. They are also gambling their own savings. So if they run out of money, or they realize it cannot be done, then there is a chance that they will just turn their back on it. They will say, how can we feed employees if our own house, we can't have money for the food? This is a reality. It's a painful reality, but it's a reality. Another thing is that, you know, like, even if a company is successful, like, you know, today you see Moonfrog. I think they have Teen Patti Gold. Before Moonfrog, Octro was a hit. They also had a Teen Patti game. Before that, there were other companies which were small and big hits. But, you know, if their app stops making money, then they have lost the money. They have lost the opportunity. Because all the good people, over time, they will have to get rid of them and keep just a core of the people. And to this effect, there is a saying in Texas where, unlike the Arab world, where there are sheikhs with lots of cheap labor, in Texas they say that if we knew that it will not last forever, then we would have been more careful and we would not have wasted the money we were making the last time we had an oil boom. that when they are digging for oil, the oil well lasts for just a few years. So while the oil well is there, it's black gold coming out of the ground. But one day it stops. So that's the kind of things that happen. Like even the company, the guy who started Octro, his name is Saurabh Agarwal. And before he started Octro, he had started another company sitting in the US, which was an instant messenger for Palm OS devices. And that brought them hundreds of thousands of dollars. But he realized that to grow it, he will have to take money from investors. So they got an offer for millions of dollars to sell that company, and they sold it. He became part of the acquired company. Then he became part of Nokia, which bought that company. And then he left it and he started Octro. So after he started Octro, for 2, 3, 4, 5 years, he kept trying to make the same thing he had made earlier. And they kept failing. Finally, they said that instead of an instant messenger, why don't we use this instant messaging technology to make a card game? And if we are making a card game and we let people play in real time, the way you send messages in real time, then maybe Indians will be interested, especially if you make a game like Teen Patti Flash. And you can see that Octro was a hit and they did well. But of course, if you saw their game, you saw there were gaps in the user experience. Like at least 2, 3 years back, if you see it, sometimes it will show the prices of the in-app items in dollars, or it will mix dollars and rupees, or there will be other small inconsistencies. So seeing that gap in the market, other companies like Moonfrog and others came with other versions of that app. And I'll just come to why this history lesson is relevant. But so the same companies which invested in Octro, they also put 100 crore rupees in Moonfrog, the company which compete with Octro, and so on. So today, for example, Teen Patti by Octro is not such a hit. It is a hit, it's making money, but they are still now chasing the next big thing. So the glory that was there is not there. And the guys who were hired when the boom was there, they have to prove their value in building the next great thing, or else over time, that opportunity will slip. Same with Moonfrog. Their Teen Patti was a hit. Then they came up with the Alia Bhatt game and other games. But now I think they are making a Ludo King or Ludo Club game. And they are just trying to acquire users. They are not figured out how to make money on that yet. And so that is a reality. And what you can do if you are an artist or you are a programmer or you are a designer in that situation is that you can focus on trying to make your skills into the best. Like if you are flying an aeroplane as a pilot for an airline which is failing also, even if you are flying for Kingfisher Airlines and Vijay Mallya is going to get destroyed, you can still try to become the best possible pilot. You know, this is an important analogy because in other industries, they say, okay, wo banda sarkari hai, that man is a government of, is a bureaucrat. He is sarkari. It means that a guy who just works 9 to 5 and he tries to act loud with others that, look, this is my rules, he will still survive because he is not the pilot. He's just a passenger. In this industry, you don't have passengers. Either you are a pilot who can fly a plane from anywhere to anywhere else in the world, or you are a crew member who's supporting a pilot where there is more space to fail, but for which you need to be a very good team player, or you are a passenger. If the airline runs out of money, the first thing they will stop money on is passengers. They'll say, okay, these are dead weight. But as long as the company is doing well, it's almost like a kingdom or a government that there is enough space for everybody and there are rewards. But this is a lesson that I would say to everybody in the game industry, that in a hit-driven industry, either you are a pilot or you are a crew member who at some level is needed by the pilot. That the pilot says, I will not fly unless the crew is there who can control the passengers and manage the plane. Or you are a passenger. And in this industry, if you are flying from here to there, there is no space for passengers. I'm giving you some examples. Like I talked of, like I'm not, they've not failed, but they are in that zone where they have to find something new. Another thing is that why should you want to be a pilot if you are always in risk as a designer, why do you always want to slog like hell? Now, I'm not going to discourage you from that, but rather I will tell you the positive side of the industry where everybody, it is demanded, should be a pilot. That is, like, I had a friend who was a very bright engineer. He worked with a company which used to make electronic design automation software. So, as artists, you might never have heard this acronym also, electronic design automation. But basically, what they do is that chipsets which are designed, they take the newest research into chipsets and power consumption and computing, and they turn it into software which can design those features onto the next microprocessor. So this company used to make software which was sold for millions of dollars to the chip making companies. And my friend who was a programmer, he said that, look, this software is very hard to use. The colors are ugly and they don't help a person navigate through the software. Many times somebody, the end user who has paid $1 million for the software, he sees that he's getting stuck and he's wasting hours and hours of his time and you're not productive. So this friend who was a programmer and who was from a top-notch engineering college, that is my college, he asked the designers, why are you not making it better? They said, because we are not programmers. We don't want to touch the code. We don't want to be blamed if something goes wrong. So he said that, though I'm a programmer, this is my customer's biggest pain point. And he spent weeks and months just improving the user interface. So at the end of what he did, he had the most beautiful user interface, or one of the more beautiful user interfaces in an electronic design automation software. But at the end of the year, his boss did not give him a salary hike. He realized that the way his salary is at the end of the next year is that his tax liability is increased. So he will take 700 rupees less every month than he was taking in the previous year when he was working like an animal trying to make that software better. So I said that the company has treated you badly. So he says, no, it is not the company's fault, it is my fault. Because I did not understand that the company is not market-driven. Now compare this to the game industry. If somebody is adding features that make the game beautiful and more enjoyable, then he is the person who will be recognized the first. That even if he is an intern who's working on a training stipend, the big bosses in the company will also say that, okay, this color scheme looks great. Are you getting it? So that is the beauty of the game industry. That if you are adding value, if you are doing something great, if you are making the gameplay awesome, if you are making the design awesome, and the market can see it, then you will get the rewards. Even if the company doesn't reward you and you change your job, then also everybody in your team will say, okay, this is the guy who changed it and made it beautiful. That in the span of 2 weeks, this game is like this because of him. So that is one thing. Another thing about the game industry is that just as some people in the audience had said about the results of your work coming in front of people, if you are in a role which involves results, most of the time people do not see your results. People just see what rewards you are getting and the task you are doing. But in the game industry, if let's say you are a pilot and you make a game about the Air Force and it gets 10 million downloads, then every child will say that, yes, I have played this game. They might say that, yeah, that game about Indian Air Force is very good, but it doesn't have good gameplay because it crashes sometimes. But everybody will say, yes, I have seen it. You know what I mean? So that's one more reward. And that reward is not just in terms of ego, but if you are applying for your next job, that you are carrying that reward with you. If a man on the road asks you, what have you done? And you say, I have done it. He'll say, yeah, I downloaded that game. It is 100 MB. If the game has been good. Or there was a friend of mine. He, when he was coming out of college, of school, he got into IIT also and he got into Indian Navy also. And after working in the Navy till the age of 38, he left it. And he joined a software company. So at first he didn't enjoy it because the software led totally admin job. Then he had a job where he had to gamify something. So this is not actual gaming, but it still involves that element of game and chance. And that is when he became the group CTO of this entire 1,000 crore rupee group. I'm not naming his name because I don't have his permission to say it, but that is the kind of impact that you can have when your work is in front of thousands or tens of thousands of people? So the next question is, now that you listen to a few things, should you still do it or should you not do it? Why not? Because you need to have a very long attention span. That if in the user interface there's one small thing that is wrong, maybe you have to carry it in your head and after 3 weeks come back to it to fix it. Maybe you need to be sensitive to the market, that everybody around you is saying, okay, the game industry is bad, the game industry is laying off people, it's doing this. But you need to have that vision that you are focused on your end goal. Like if you are shooting an arrow or a bullet, your eyes only see the target and your mind and your thinking is so clear that you can hit the target. Maybe as an artist, you're always looking for sensations and visions, but you still in your mind's eye need to be focused. You need to be very focused. Another thing you need is that you need the can-do attitude. That if you're in a government job and somebody comes to you and says, hey, sir, I gave the tax now, but I gave the wrong tax. No, sir, why am I being given the fine? So the natural thing in that situation is to say, well, you will have to write to the senior officer. You will have to do this. Or in our department, these are the rules. Or even you can say that, no, you go away. This is not the job of our department. But in the game industry, many times, even though something is not necessarily your job, you need the sense that everything stops with me. That you can pass this currency note around, but at some point it has to stop. And the guy has to say, I will take this and I will get this job done. So you need that kind of a spirit and attitude. Some people who have that attitude, that attitude serves them very well. Because the bosses do not care so much about who comes and says, hey, yes, sir, as they care about the one who actually gets work done. So, you know, for a lot of people, for me, for example, I'm somewhat introverted. I don't like too many rules.
Little more.
I'm not good at reading papers, following rules and all. So in that situation, but I like it that I have been given a set of work. I have to finish it. And once it's done, it's done. So if you have that sort of a spirit, attitude and mindset, then the game industry is a very good place for you. And you will be one of the few people who can make that impact. If you don't have that spirit, then also there's nothing wrong. But you have to ask yourself that, okay, maybe I can go to a place where so much of that responsibility is not on my shoulders. So this is something which I am sharing. Like when Hewlett Packard was started, that is not in the game industry, but the initial work was done for Walt Disney in terms of making certain types of things that are used in the animation industry. And one of the things about Hewlett Packard was that these two founders used to many times work with their own hands. And one day, and sometimes many times they would work at night. So one day, one of the founders saw that he came to finish the project late at night because he remembered something has not been done. And he saw that all the tools were locked. Because a new watchman who was there, he said that we will lock everything at night. So the guy, the founder, he was so angry that he took a wire cutter and he cut up the cupboards and broke the locks. And he wrote in paint in the wall, very big, he wrote, keep the tools unlocked. And he wrote that, okay, these are the rules of our garage. It's like we are working from a garage and we need to be able to work whenever and however to get our job done. So a lot of those rules apply to the game industry also. The advantage is that you can make a huge impact. The disadvantage is that anything can fall on your head at any time. If you are a junior guy trying to prove yourself, it is great because you say that, okay, I am the Virat Kohli and I am the Sachin Tendulkar and I am the warrior who will score 100 and make an impact. At the same time, you might say that, no, why is everything coming to me? So you have to decide what is your style of interest and your style of functioning and the kind of role you want. Or if somebody is there who says, look, I just want the big picture. Don't give me the details. He says, okay, whether it's Battle City or Battleships, you all played Battle City, right? You have, right? You know what's Battle City. And you might have seen Battleships, that game in Windows. So what if there's some product manager who says that, look, whether it's Battle City, Battleships, I don't know, we have a game. So if there's somebody of that nature, then probably the game industry is not a good fit for him. Because he needs to be attached to the output. He cannot say that there is a game, well, I think it is Battle City when actually it's Battleships. That you need to be involved in the product. A banker can avoid having the savings bank account, which is meant for daily wage workers. But a game industry guy has to be in touch with his product. What is it about companies that doesn't apply to the game industry? So that thing I said, that everybody is a pilot. If the pilot fails, the plane crashes. If the team which is making a game fails, the game is a flop or it's not enjoyable to play. And maybe some people are the crew, but there are no passengers in the game industry. So I'm shortening this a bit. This is a photo. Do you recognize the people in the photo? Or do you recognize one person in the photo? Okay, just say it aloud. Jorki, Jorki. Okay, who is the guy with him? Okay, you don't recognize this guy. Okay, so the other guy with him is a guy called John Sculley. So when Steve Jobs had founded Apple in a garage and a lot of investors were putting money, they said, get somebody experienced at marketing and management to be the big boss, the CEO. So they found John Sculley, who had worked with Apple, and they made him the CEO. Sorry, they found John Sculley, who had worked with Pepsi, and they made him the CEO. At first, he was scared that, okay, I'm working in a software big multinational. How can I come to a startup? But Steve Jobs convinced him. And the result was that John Sculley did not care about the details of technology. He was a guy whom people will call a number clucker, that he will make marketing forecasts. He will predict what is the cheapest rate to buy advertising. He'll do this and that. But he didn't care about the computer or the user experience the way Steve Jobs does. Everybody who buys an iPhone or uses an iPad, they know that user experience is everything in Apple products. So when Steve Jobs would keep arguing about user experience, at some time, John Sculley got irritated and he fired Steve Jobs from his own company. He told Steve Jobs, get lost. And Steve Jobs left Apple and threw away all his Apple shares at a cheap price and he got into Pixar. But you also have people like that. And if somebody is thinking from that point of view, there is no harm if somebody is an MBA, he's working with Coke or Pepsi and he's doing good. But that level and that style of thinking is very different from the kind of thinking that involves user experience. And even though Apple products are not as such games, but they have those elements of user experience and addictiveness that make a game successful, that make a product successful, because a user feels delighted to use them because of their quality and their attention to detail. And I'm not trying to be negative, but I'm just trying to point out that when somebody is giving you advice, you need to ask yourself that, are they the guy who thinks like the chairman of Coke and Pepsi, even if he's your senior and very respected relative? Or is it some relative who can think like Steve Jobs? You know, because not everybody can be Steve Jobs, but if your bent of mind is in that direction, then you have to ask yourself which advice you will act on and which advice you have to think is not applicable so much to your life if you are in that sort of a mode. So like the brighter side is that people who are in the game industry, when they are working, like I had a boss once, he's now the CEO of another very big gaming company in India. So I was a lead programmer, but nobody used to listen to me. So one day I said that, sir, if we work through the weekend, we will complete this, but how to make people stay through the weekend and not waste time or go away? So he said, what should we do? So I said that, sir, if you sit through the weekend, then as long as you are sitting, because they respect you so much, they will not go away from front of you and they will keep working. So he said that, you know, my wife has something planned for Sunday. I said, well, can't you tell her that I can't come back home on Sunday, on a Friday? Rahul? So the boss said that, look, I can't tell her that I can't come back on the Sunday, but I will switch off my phone and I'll sit with you. So he switched off the phone and he sat with us. On Monday morning, the reception was ringing with calls and the wife said that, listen, where is my husband? Our boss's wife. She said, I'm going to phone the police if you do not tell me where my husband is. He said that, look, I'm here. And he told the receptionist, give me the phone. And the wife was crying and she was screaming, because the boss had forgotten his own wedding anniversary. That he was so focused on trying to make his team achieve, and the team was also so focused and respectful, that everybody worked through the weekend and the boss forgot his own anniversary. So in any other industry, that doesn't happen. That if a big boss says that work the weekend, very few times the big boss himself will work. Mostly he will talk through managers that you should do this. But the game industry is an industry where this kind of things happen. And to me, this is like a reward. That even if I'm just 23, the boss and I are in the same team. And I may be the guy in IPL who's getting 10,000 rupees a month, but Sachin Tendulkar, who's getting 2 crores or 5 crores, is also going to bat and ball in the same team as me, as long as we are in the field. So to me, personally, I think that is the biggest reward of being in the game industry. And I don't know if that reward sounds good enough to you, but once you work in any other industry and you experience that sense that the your boss or management is taking you for granted and you see a good game company, your mind will say that, take me where everybody fights together and everybody is a team. And this aspect that it's one all for one and one for all. Another case, the team was so tightly bound that there was a guy, a manager, who came 10 years after he had worked with somebody to the wedding of a guy who was very junior when he was working, even though his wife's father had passed away the previous day. That aspect of being attached to the team, it applies not just to work, but also to personal life. And many times when you build connections and relationships, then unlike in other industry where people don't care after you've gone home, everybody is very attached, everybody is playing together almost like a sports team. And there are folks who became legends. So, I don't know if you've seen these guys on the extreme right side. Do you recognize this game and these people? Okay, so there was a game called Crossy Road. I don't know, maybe you've not played it, maybe you've not heard of it, but it was a hit, it was a super, super hit, super hit. That those who like it, they like it more than Angry Birds. And the guy on the left is a guy called Matt Hall, an Australian, who ran the 2% company, which was a remote company, that the guy on the Chinese looking guy is from Singapore and the Australian guy is Matt Hall. And they built Crossy Road. It got tens of millions of downloads, it was a super, super, super hit. I would consider them a success. This logo, green one, is the logo of Moonfrog. And who can forget Angry Birds? That sometimes we find a relative and we say Angry Bird game, and they say, oh, but I thought Angry Bird only makes school bags and pencil boxes. This is an Angry Birds game also. So, you know, you might say that, look, we are just students and designers, and how can we think at such a huge level? But the people behind all these companies, they were also young. Maybe early 20s, maybe mid 20s, maybe late 20s, but they managed that success. And if you also manage and connect with the right team and you give it your best shot, then not just Crossy Road, not just Moonfrog, which is huge in Bangalore, and not just Angry Birds, but even the level of Walt Disney, you can do stuff. I'm now going to sort of bring this presentation to a close. I don't know if it's been interesting or exciting or informative, but I felt I should share some of the experiences and give you some context. And if you want this presentation, I'm happy to email it to you people. My email ID is nsnsns@gmail.com. You can take a photo of this slide and just drop me an email. I'll mail you this presentation. Maybe I'll add a few notes to it, so it can be useful to all of you. Another thing I request you to do is to please scan this QR code and give some good feedback rating if you think it is good. Or if it's bad, then also you can write that also. So I'll be very grateful if you could do that, because at this time, much of the audience is gone, but that is it. And if I can ever be of help, I can ever give advice, I mean, just ask and I'll try to reply. Maybe I'll reply over a blog post or something instead of in a personal mail, but I'll try to answer it and I'll send you a link to wherever I've answered it. Okay, so that was it. If any of you have questions, I can listen to 5 questions and I'll then give one long answer which satisfies all the questions that are asked. So that if some questions have things in common, then I can collapse it into one common answer. So, okay, come forward and ask questions, people. Any questions?
We've kind of gone over, but, you know, it's okay. Yeah. If anybody has a question on anything that doesn't said, anybody?
I mean, if you have any question at all about game industry careers. Do you have a question, guy with the next to my tripod? What do you do? Okay. So yeah, I mean, just absorb and think about some of the things I've said, and give me a round of applause or give me a good feedback on the QR code.